En inmiddels tweemaal langer mee dan mislukte imitatie.
This is the BBC, with the Daily Minutes podcast. Oh no, it isn't. I mean, this is the Daily Minutes podcast. This is however not the BBC.
Als er een natuurramp gebeurt, vertrouw jij dan je leven toe aan het feit dat mobiele telefoons en internetverbindingen nog werken? Vertrouw je daar het leven van je gezinsleden aan toe? Ik dacht het niet. Amateurradio, communicatie die altijd blijft werken.
Today is the first day of the rest of your life. And what a good day, to have a good day.
Daily Minutes, 24 August 2021. It's the Bulletin of Tuesday. Daily Minutes, 24 August 2021. This is our Bulletin of Tuesday. Well, I must confess something. I do miss doing the Daily Minutes each day quite a bit. And I don't know why, because maybe it is because it is some distraction from my work. If I do the video, I do that on moments that are convenient and not at a fixed time, and that seems to matter to me. It's emotional, but notwithstanding that. But I also miss talking about a lot of things, even though sometimes the public wasn't too big. So I don't know what I'm going to do with that. I might recommence the daily minutes. But I also need time to do the video, so that's a bit of a problem. Because I know if I do the daily shows, I won't do enough on the video, on the plans with the video that I have. So I'm still thinking about that, but it's probably that I'm going to do the Daily Minutes at least more often than I did the last couple of weeks. These kinds of problems pop up when you have more time, and as expected, not everyone returned from holiday. There are a few colleagues that went even this week and last week, but it's a lot less hectic than it was for several weeks. So it's always a bit of a battle in the holiday season, because I don't often go away. Or sometimes for a long weekend, not longer than that. And my last very long holiday of 3 weeks was in 2000. So I don't like going on holiday. I do like going out. I do like going to cities, explore things, ride my bike, etc. But I don't like going away from home long for a longer time. I sometimes consider having some pied-à-terre, I don't know how you call that in English, but kind of a second home for the weekends to relax, or even to write on books. I won't know how that would work out. Perhaps I should rent something to try it out, because I think I'm too steady fixed to my location to move a lot, although I did that for 9 years between two cities in the Netherlands, and that wasn't a problem at all. It was actually quite nice having kind of two lives in parallel, because in the one city I did completely different things than in the other. In one city my then girlfriend lived, and I was mostly there, and I had to be in the town where I live now for at least 2.5 days each week, because I had 3 days a week work here. So, but that went very well, and even for some time I had a day extra here because my girlfriend was working then, and it was convenient to do things here. So Well, that worked out quite fine, and I did feel at home in both cities, more in the other city than here, by the way, but in both cities things have changed, I have changed, and I'm quite good off now. I would like to have a kind of a tiny home. I'm thinking about that for a long time. I think it wouldn't be practical for me to live in a tiny home, or perhaps in case I have a business kind of building or some part of a building with the possibility and being allowed to sleep there, because that's not always permitted on an industrial park or something, partly because of safety considerations, but that would be nice. And also the tiny home, if I have two locations, would be very nice to ride there, because of the lack of distractions. I wouldn't have as much work things, hobby things there probably. Which was also true for the period I worked here in the city of Amersfoort and practically lived in the city of Nijmegen. I only had a couple of necessities there, and I didn't do much on the radio amateur hobby, so that was also quite easy. Only sometimes I had an HT with me, but never larger rigs or something. But I didn't have antennas there as well. And my then girlfriend, as always my girlfriends, I think, didn't like technical things, technical stuff. Didn't understand that, didn't understand my fascination for it. I thought it was an unnecessary expense. And, well, that was not the reason I stopped a few years later, but it probably kept me at least a little bit from doing a lot in her presence with this hobby that I was doing a very little. I only had very little interest in it as well. So I must confess, I didn't like technical people then, and also not always very fond of them. Their directness and sometimes insensitivity, and always think they're right. That's a problem, because I'm always right, and that shouldn't be contested. So, yeah. But practical. I'm clearing out my house. I had planned that for a long time. I did do a couple of things about it. I started a few weeks ago, even when it was very busy, and it cost me. It wasn't quite an effort, because I was tired, and but now this is the first day it was really quiet in 4 or 5 months, as long as that. But and I even was quite busy part of the day today as well. But this evening there is the D-Star net, which I'm the net control for, and. Last couple of weeks, I didn't at all have time for that, and I did keep it short, because I had to go away and think of my work. I was distracted, and well, today I'm starting to slow down a bit, being more zen, and I also started in a higher gear. With the clearing up, which is really necessary. I have very much trouble to keep things empty and clean. And what added to that was my bad vision that I had until 2.5 months ago. I also didn't see when things were dirty or dusty, or I really didn't see it. And well, when I got my vision largely back, I had a bit of a shock, I must confess. So I'm fixing that now, bit by bit. You can't do everything. Last week, I don't know the day, but it was really early, I think Friday, I threw away as much as 14 dirt bags, almost full of all kind of stuff that simply should be thrown away and was thrown away. And right now, today I filled four of those bags again, so it's going, it's a drop on a hot plate, not more than that, but I think eventually if I carry this on, this might work. You have to create your own milestones, that's the only thing that works, and concentrate on only very few things at a time. And in such a way you see your results, because that motivates. I know very well how, but I'm a bit of a I'm easily distracted, kind of a nutty professor or something like that. I'm easily distracted and then fully concentrated on a subject that is much more interesting than clearing up your house and cleaning up your house. And but it has its own quality, because doing that kind of chores, you get to think about things as well. That at least that works for me very well, but not in a time when I'm really, really busy, which I was for several months, with only a few exceptions. So I decided not to let my agenda fill that, or be that crowded again for at least a couple of months, and put a bit of a break on it, because it really was too bad. So, but what to do with the daily minutes? I'm not sure. I do want to make videos. I'm not very good at it, as it appears. Not as good as I would want, at least. So I have to get some more experience. Even my English is not as good as when I do the podcasts. I already explained that. Probably this is the distraction, that you also have to use your hands and do all kinds of things, manipulate the camera. And that distracts so much. But I even had it outside when I recorded the video of the Texan receiver outside, that my English was not as good as it is really now. So that I have to work on that, because it can be. And it's solvable, so it should be solved. But I also want to keep doing radio, so that is completely clear. So I'm going to do more of these podcasts as did. And I might perhaps, I did want to start a series with video, together with video, but I'm not sure what I, Pascal has sent me quite a lot of texts, which I still plan to use very soon. But also when it's that busy, that won't work as well. But I'm not sure whether I'm going to do them, with video or, completely with audio, or only some with video, which is also a possibility. You can show all kinds of things. For example, with the hyperbolic navigation, with series is already done in Dutch and largely in English. So I think I won't pick that up again. But I had quite a lot of images that I could use as a kind of a slideshow together with the audio. So that's a possibility as well, which is much more time consuming than doing only the audio. What I do now is the most easy to get a lot of content, because, I turn the tab open and out come words, and they are somewhat coherent, so understandable. But that's a lot more difficult if you do a series, which you have to prepare, which you have to write, which don't go always very well when you read the scripts for it, and you do 3-4 takes for some parts at least. And that's quite time consuming. So that that kind of broadcasts are often limited to 5 or 10 minutes each day. Much more I can't do. And if I do the video together, I probably won't have more material than 1.5 minutes or so each day, because that's the only thing I have time for. If I use up all my available time for this, that's what it amounts to. So I don't know if I'm prepared to let my daily show suffer that much for it. So if it's going to turn out that I do one or two videos each week and the rest audio, that might be a good possibility. So I still want to keep doing English, because in part the last year or 1.5 years, I've done a lot of experimenting and looking what I want to do with the podcast. And just before I started doing a larger video, the amount of people listening was decreasing the amount. So sometimes I don't mind, because when I'm still developing concepts and thinking about that is not always too interesting to hear. But I would want to have a few hundred listeners at least. And that's not what it was. And by doing English, it is much more easy to create a larger audience. And perhaps I do. I didn't do that with one of my blogs, which was my web blogs, which was quite successful. I did earn a decent amount of money with that. So that's not the primary reason why I do it, but it's nice if it works out that way. And it's also motivating. So it is quite kind of important. So and when doing English, that is all, which I can do. It's not difficult to me. So doing English, it's much more easy to accomplish. And also, people don't know me. If I do the ham radio stuff in the Dutch realm, many people know me of the broadcasts I did on shortwave. I still do on shortwave. And of the repeater broadcasts that I did on the 2-meter band and on 70 cents. So, and I really want to do things that are at least somewhat different from that. I think I do want to add more popular science to it. And that has also the advantage that you can interest people much more easy to into the ham radio hobby, which is not a purpose of the podcasts, but to some extent, well, it was really the purpose of the repeater broadcast. Many people didn't understand that. The established ham radio operators sometimes told me, "This is not for me. Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that?" Now, I really did the broadcasts then to interest new people to the hobby, and that worked fantastically well in the 6 or 7 years I did so. So, especially the digital part of the broadcast, I transmitted a lot of SSTV images and FLDigi experiments and all kinds of things and different modes, several modes together, etc. People find that amazingly interesting, and quite a lot of people started with a scanner, a police scanner that they bought very cheaply from a thrift store or something, or a kind of a radio market for only a few euros. And that developed into doing their ham radio exam and being a radio amateur, in spite of not wanting to do that in the first place, not being the person. But they got sucked into the hobby, so to say. And that was kind of how I planned it. And I think at least there are several tens of new ham radio operators, and mostly people that have a large interest in technical stuff, which is also very, very much an advantage, because I don't want it to become a communication hobby. It's a technical hobby, so and it's not a problem if you only do the QSO stuff, but it would be nice if there is at least some inflow of new hams that are interested in the technical side of the hobby as well. And that's what really worked very well. So, but it's not right now. It's not a purpose, but it could work out that way, because if I do much more broad technical stuffs, for example, the popular science or doing scientific experiments, that I'm a great fan of the show What Could Possibly Go Wrong. It is so funny as well, because you have two presenters, and only part of the listeners knows that, but you have two presenters, and one is a kind of an army guy and the other one is a science man, but they both look quite rough if they are part of a motor gang or something, with somewhat less tattoos, but but they sit together, watch YouTube movies or so similar from another side, and then they see people do experiments and wonder if they could do that themselves, if it is not a trick or something like that, or a stint it isn't even possible. But then they start working on it, and I can't do the iron welding and that kind of things. I'm not good in that, but on a certain scale that could be adopted in the video show. So I would like that very much, if I can do that a little bit. And I certainly still want to do the interviews, and I don't know if I'm going to do them in Dutch or probably in English. So I have to get people that are fluent enough speaking the language. And I'm a very experienced interviewer for magazines. I've done them in Dutch mostly, but I think I did 20 to 25% also in English and in German, writing them down in Dutch. But so I can interview in English. That is something I did. But doing that for radio or for video is much more different from what I did. But I know which questions to ask. I don't do very well know the structure. I have some kind of an aura that people like telling me things, and I sometimes like to listen. Mostly not enough, but I do really do like to listen. I'm very interested. A good story, you can wake me up for any moment. So, but I also like to tell, and I have to be less dominant in these conversations. So, probably there's still a lot of work to do as well there. But I like to learn. That is the reason why I stopped partly with the audio and started doing much more video. But I like both, so we have to see. And there is a lot of competition also, because I started doing audio and video on my website in the 90s. So then I was practically the only one in my country, so that was quite special. I do remember the first video I saw on the internet. I think it was Windows 95, and I saw this in this German program with the three gentlemen. I've forgotten until a few years ago they did a podcast, a video podcast as well, but Computer Show, I'm not sure. But I saw the new operating system, which I didn't have and hadn't seen, and there was a tiny stamp size moving image in their screen, which was video, and that was amazing. on a computer screen in that time. And I still know what it was. It was a windsurfer, and it was an image that was, I think it was, it came with Windows 95. It wasn't 3.11, I think. But the first videos, I don't know if you call that a container, but the operating system didn't have borders between the programs. So if the video crashed, which happened a lot if you had a somewhat different codec, but it didn't prevent the complete system from halting, and then you had the blue screens, etc. And later there came some kind of containers in which each program ran in its own container and didn't hang up the complete system if something went wrong. But then that wasn't the case, but I was intrigued by the video, and I thought I wanted that. This was my reoccurring problem with the batteries of the Tascam recorder. I don't know what was still recorded. I was telling about Windows 95, where I saw my first video on a TV, on a computer screen. And this was in a German program where I forgot the name, but it was a stamp size image of a windsurfer, which I think came with Windows 95. And then I told that in the early days, video often crashed to complete the computer system because the programs didn't run in separate containers then. And if one program crashed, then it could hang up the complete system or give the infamous blue screen. That was the first video I saw, and I was really mesmerized by it. And after that, the second thing I saw was for a magazine, RAM, where I worked for 12 and a half years. That was, I think it was a program, probably not a website, that you could download, and then you could see very small images. Maybe I still had a telephone modem, so it was that long ago. I'm quite sure I did have, because my first broadband I had in 2001. So that was even with a telephone modem, and I could see very small images. And one of the first things I saw was a soap opera from South Korea, and that was so amazingly, because from so far away, and until that moment, you could only see the far away TV stations with sporadic e-propagation and an antenna on your roof. And nothing else. So, just as amazed I was with the first IRC chat that I did. In the first or the second IRC chat I did, I looked up a channel with Australians, really, because I think they are the farthest away from me. And then I asked them to switch, to push the enter button. At the same time, they saw I did it, and it was instantly. It was absolutely directly. So the distance from here to Australia went in an instant, even then, and that was very special, very very special. And well, the same was for the video. So very soon, I thought, how can I implement that on my own website? So within a few months, I had that. I described how to do that, even in the RAM magazine, which was a scanner, 27 megahertz, and ham radio magazine. So it wasn't the primary topic, but it was new, and internet was a kind of a hype. So every magazine had, if they had to do with it or not, they had something about websites. But this was amazing. And then I got to the real player, which was one of the first platforms, and made my own video and experimented with that. So that was around probably 96, 97-ish. so really long ago. And after that, I started experimenting with audio. I didn't have streams then, but what I did was make playlists, and they weren't even called playlists then as well. But on a website, I had a kind of a streaming program, which was from Microsoft, and that I had actually two separate players, one for the Explorer, Internet Explorer system. And on the Mozilla-like browsers, it automatically chose that. And it was even possible, which I have done sometimes, to offer the Internet Explorer people a different video from the Mozilla. Mosaic, early it was Mosaic, but later it wasn't Firefox then. But however, it was a different browser than Explorer, and later that became Firefox, the Firefox approach. So that was nice, and I created with because of that. I had to get to know the technology behind it. So I got involved with XML files. The playlists were in XML, which brought me later to the RSS feeds as well, which is the same technology. And I made playlists, and then I put the new videos at the start of the every time at the beginning of the existing playlists. So if people were watching or listening, they first got the newest and then the one before that, etc. And that was well before that there were even podcasts or something. Streaming is a lot more difficult and much more sophisticated approach with a media server and so on. And I was quite early with that as well. But what I want to say is that I do the audio quite long. I didn't record much in video. I have done some videos. I have done editing at a time, but editors weren't very sophisticated, very, very good. I bought Pinnacle, which was a printed circuit board, which you could put in your one of the slots from your computer, and it was very difficult to get it running. Very, very difficult. I had a lot of calls with several help desks, and I discovered getting the equipment running that the new PC I bought for it and the company of Pinnacle had their help desk, their technical help desk, in the same building. So I even had people from one company going to the other floor to the other company to ask how to solve my problem. So I had that as well, and I could receive their signals, then the analog signals from an antenna, but also from the cable network. And a long time I had a small image in my screen where a news where I could see the news and all that kind of things. That developed into doing audio much more, and then the podcast came. And I didn't know what to do with that whatsoever. So at first I simply said stupid things like rhymes and all kinds of... I don't like to listen to those old recordings, which still are on the internet. But you have to look very well for them, because they are hidden quite well. But from that I started... doing ever better podcasts. And also the time when I worked for television, I've done only very much background work, like doing a website for a program and so on. But I did ask people there what they liked about what I did. And that feedback helped me very, very much, very substantially. As for my website design, as well as for the podcast and so on. So I kept improving that. But a long time I did only the podcast style from the beginning, which was very loose. And what you also did was, and that I still do that when there are disturbances, for instance, the cat is causing a problem or making lots of noise. I don't remove that. I often use that. And that's typically podcast and typically podcast philosophy from the early days. But it's nice to do that. And a lot of people don't understand that do radio, that are used to radio or used to listening to radio, don't understand that and think it's just beginner stuff what I do there. But that isn't the case. But I'm when I did a podcast with the title Daily Minutes on Ham Radio, which was an experiment. I did 40 or 50 of them in a few months' time. In the early days, I did each day a show, but after that, they became more sparse. And a year later, I started doing the weekly broadcasts on one of the 2 meter repeaters. And then it started to sound more and more like audio, but it was very experimental. So, but I want to do a bit the things a bit more professional. What I do now is purely podcast, talk away a bit and just go with the flow. But I want to professionalize that a bit more, and at the same time keeping it a podcast or a vlog kind of thing. And the difference between the largest difference between doing a radio on a serial radio, on a traditional radio station, and the same goes for television, and a podcast or a vlog, that is that doing radio you have an exact amount of time, and also for television, but especially radio, and you have to fill that time. You can't see, but you also have to stop at an exact moment, because there is the news or the next show that has to begin at that time. And the nice thing about a podcast is that if you have inspiration, you can, like I have today apparently, you can talk away a lot and just see where it ends. But, well, if it turns out to be that is not the case, you don't have to go on. And you simply can end the show for that day and say, nah, tomorrow better, or tomorrow I will tell the rest of the story. okay, but I sometimes call that meta podcasts. I did in Dutch also call it, and that are podcasts about how I will or want to do the podcast in the future. And I always decide not to do such shows, but well, today we have another one. But there is, it makes sense today. Ik bedoel, that was a Dutch word, but I mean, things have changed. I don't like not doing at least one in each 2 days a kind of podcast like this. Well, the Dutch is coming. The Dutch is surfacing above the water, above the horizon. I don't know what it is. I have only had that in the last couple of weeks, and that is since I am only doing English. So the Dutch feels discriminated and also wants to have a say, I guess. But, well, let's see. I have one video left that is not published, and I have a couple of ideas for videos. But they, as I said, they need preparation. They need editing. They need to look professional. So that's also extra work. I want to do a good job with them. So, once every 2 or 3 days, and very shortly, it is not. It is simply not enough. I have to offer. I have more to offer. So. That really is the case, and if you don't like it, you don't have to listen. But and even if no one listens, I still have to tell it. But it is good in a way. That way you stay original. Let's continue. Let's have a conclusion to this, because. It's getting a bit thin now. And I also have to do, but I have time today, I also have to do the DStarNet this evening. So maybe you want to participate in that too. Okay. This podcast is made by myself. I'm Peter John in English Media. Title music is by Croatian artist Blasko and is published under Creative Commons. You can find this podcast on dmpodcast.net, DM is for Daily Minutes, and on several other platforms. De internetfaciliteiten en studio hardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl, 70MHzShop.nl.
Daily Minutes Podcast. Whoever hears this is crazy.
En microfoon naar retour.
Deze uitzending wordt opgedragen aan Jurgen van den Broek, ON3JVB, voor altijd de Joker van België.